20, but as he says, the scripture will be fulfilled. The Holy Spirit spoke beforehand by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who was the guide to those arrested Jesus. He was numbered among us, he was allotted his share in the ministry. Now this man bought a field with the reward of his wickedness, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his bowels gushed out. It became known as to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so the field was called in their language, Akeldama, the field of blood. It is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation become desolate, let there be no one to live in it, and his office let another take. So one of the men who had accompanied us during all that time, the Lord went with the open men also, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these men was to come with us, a witness to his resurrection, and to put forward two and out of those my children. Okay, so last week we had a quick look at the summary of the apostles. When they returned to Jerusalem, they went to the upper room and they made steadfast in prayer and unity. And this week we're going to have a look at the appointment of Matthias. Well, leading up to the appointment and the appointment of Matthias, hopefully. So, Psalms are quoted by Peter in verse 20 and also by Jesus in John 13, verse 18, reminding us that God, in his wisdom many years ago, knew what would happen, and down through time, in his foreknowledge, he allowed to the mouth of David certain things to be said. And in the life of Jesus, Jesus quotes certain of these things, and then it's picked up by the Apostle Peter also. And the reality is that God knew that Judas would betray Jesus. And he also knew that someone else would have to take Judas's place amongst the 12. So, applied to Judas in the betrayal in Psalm 41 verse 9, says, yes, my own familiar friend, in whom I trusted, who ate of my bread, has lifted up his heel against me. That's a terrible indictment. You know, to be betrayed by somebody that you don't know, that's bad enough. But to be betrayed by someone who you've walked with, talked with, helped out, encouraged, and all these other things, for them to turn around and stab you in the back, well, in this case, even worse. It's a long phrase, really. Anyway, for him to turn around and betray Jesus in this way, that hurts even more deeply on a personal level. And Jesus was a human being, like, in his situation here on earth. He was just as human as you and I. And if we trust someone and that person lets us down, it hurts, no matter how we try and deal with that. There is that element from which it hurts. And that's why many people, as they live their lives, you know, sometimes some people become very cynical and some people become very hard. And often that happens because of the amount of times where they've opened themselves up to people in times past and then been hurt. So each time it happens, they withdraw a little bit further back into themselves and think, well, I'm not going to allow myself to be put in a situation where I'll be hurt again. Apostle Paul, like writing on later Romans, he turns around and says, don't get weary. Don't become weary in well-doing. And it's so easy to become frustrated, to feel let down by people, and allow that then to have an effect. Yes?
Graham, do you think Judas knew they were going to crucify him?
That's an interesting question.
I watched something once, but I don't know if one of those stories, Christmas stories, right? And it was like he told them where he was and all that, right? So they don't kill him. No, because they were saying they were gonna kill him.
Right.
Yeah. No, right. And they told them where he was and all that, so he don't kill him. But that is just
I think that's a Christmas
story one.
I would think. It was something interesting. I think you were talking about a children's Bible in which they have a look in the Oxfam and places like that the other day. I actually found one, but I had a quick flip through it and I realised that they'd taken a bit of liberty with a bit too much liberty with some of the text and just took it back. I didn't buy it for you. Okay. We'll get a better one. And that's sometimes what happens. I mean, we've got some of the films. I don't know whether it's the one you watched, John. When they've got a film of John, the life of John's Gospel, and you have Satan appears as a female. Very nice. That's attractive. But it's a little bit of liberty with the text. Sometimes what happens with films, sometimes you've got to be careful. There's a number of different ideas of why Judas did what he did, but the main one seems to come through that he was a zealot, and he had this idea of the physical kingdom and the overthrow of Rome, and he was kind of almost fed up with Jesus seeming to take too long, and he wanted to force Jesus' hand to do something. That seems to be one of the main ones. You got another one, Fred?
Well, John says Judas was a thief and carried the bag.
So just did it for the money. Reason.
That gives you an understanding why the scriptures also say that Satan entered the heart of Judas, and Judas, on the basis of that, went to bargain with the priest for 30 pieces of silver. In other words, he may have been disappointed and disillusioned, but Satan evidently led him astray, or made use of him, and Jesus actually said himself, it were better for that man if he had not been born. Now, if the man didn't deliberately betray Jesus, there was no sin involved in it.
No.
If it was by accident he did it, or a misunderstanding, I can't for the life of me believe that Jesus would have said, it were better for that man if he had not been born.
So just about for the money was the main reason.
Well, okay. John puts his finger on it.
Yeah.
He said, when Judas said, why wasn't this ointment sold for 30, all this money, and the money given to the poor? John said this, he said, because, not because he cared aught for the poor, anything for the poor, but because he was a thief and carried the bag.
If you got that money,
John must have known he was misappropriating some of the funds.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. So it's interesting, it's more negative things
One further comment, Graham.
Yeah.
This business of excusing Judas really began when a woman, Marie Corelli, wrote a book in which she defended what Judas did, and that took off with some of the so-called intellectuals, you know.
Right, I remember that one. Long time ago,
It's a long time ago.
Okay.
When you were a little boy.
Probably. I read all the old books, all the books, and all the big. Matter of fact, I always remember, when I was younger, I thought I was brilliant. Okay? you grow out of that eventually. But anyway, I had written something and something I was studying, and I thought, I have never seen that anywhere on that text. I think that's cutting edge theology. And I picked up in one of these old bookshops, something like 1780 or 1800s, and here's this guy, he's written the same as that. He's stolen my idea. Would you believe that? Nothing new under the sun. Anyway. So I wasn't the only brilliant one. Anyway, so the Holy Spirit spoke by the mouth of David. So here, and David wouldn't have understood some of the things that he was writing way back then. But in the fulfillment of prophecy, then we look back in time, we can see the overall picture, and the implication is that what was spoken by David so long ago was spoken by the Holy Spirit. He spoke by inspiration. Inspiration is an important element, both in the Old Testament and New Testament. A lot of people think of the Bible, people who are not religious, and some people are, sadly, who are religious. Just think of the Bible as some sort of basic storybook that men put together. As though 40 men put it together over a period of 1,400-1,500 years. And they just think it was a bit of a fluke that all this stuff came together. But they don't appreciate that God's Word is God's Word. God has spoken. And he is the author, ultimate author of the Word of God. It's God's workshop manual for man. And therefore, the concept of inspiration is very important. Inspiration and common terms say God breathed, that which God breathed into these men of time past. That's one of the phrases used, we'll come across again. So, we're talking about verbal or plenary inspiration. And you see examples of that in 2 Samuel 23, verse 2, and Jeremiah 1, verse 9. It actually says that God placed his word in their mouths of these Old Testament writers. 2 Peter 1 verse 21 and then 2 Timothy 3 verse 16 has a similar idea. No scripture comes of man's own interpretation, but God spoke, or men spoke as were moved by God in the Old Testament and in the other part of the New Testament. And so you have God having inspire these men to say certain things that they wouldn't always understand the context or the impact of what they were going to say then through time. But looking back in time, we can see how what they said came to fulfillment. And so this is an important concept all the way through. So we can have confidence in the Word of God. God has just...
What does plenary mean?
Frank, what does plenary mean?
It means verbal. It means in words. Plenary is the expensive word for verbal.
That's why I put it in. I'm not cheap in this class. You know?
Inspiration in words.
All right, so these passages, and there's lots of other passages that actually give us this idea, but it's an important one for us to understand. Some people say, well, you know, there's lies in the Bible. There's lies in the Bible. Well, that's true. God intended for those lies to be written down. For example, Satan lies all the time. And we have God recording those, accurately recording for our benefit. Looking back in time, we can see the impact of that. And there's a lots of truth in the Bible. And God intended for us to get to know these things. And that's part of the job of the apostles that we've been talking about in this other part of the chapter, that they were going to be guided into all truth. So therefore, the truth that they've been guided into has now been written down, and we can get the benefit of that. We can understand what was in the mind of God, what God planned for his people. When God created us, he didn't leave us to our own devices. And in the New Testament, especially for us today and relevant for us today, God has given us a blueprint, if you will, for how to live our lives, the kind of attitude we need to have. Again, in Romans, especially the latter parts in chapters 12, 13, and 14, Paul goes to great pains to say about we need to be challenged by the renewal of our minds. We need to put our minds in a different frame, if you will, into God's thinking, God's way of looking at things and God's way of thinking. So we no longer do things as the world used to do them. We change our attitude, change our lifestyle, and change our viewpoints based upon what we understand what God wants for us. And we're guided in that through the Word of God, because the Word of God is the sword of the Spirit. That's what God has revealed for us to get to know. And it's practically most of the books, apart from the historical book of Acts and the four Gospels which deal with the life of Jesus, the other 21 books of the New Testament deal with church problems. And we have an inspired record of how did the church deal with these things in the first century. And the funny thing is, or the sad thing is, that humans often make the same mistakes down through history. We find exactly the same attitudes of envy, of jealousy, of pride that they had back then. And so how did the early apostles deal with these people and what did they challenge them to do? It's just as practical for us today as we apply these things in our life today. So we are still guided by God and the Holy Spirit through his word to be the kind of people God wants us ultimately to be. And the same promises that God laid down, both Old Testament and New Testament promises, God has shown himself faithful. And because he's shown himself faithful in the things that have already taken place, we can have confidence he's going to continue to be faithful in all the promises he still holds in store for us for our future. And so we can have confidence in the word of God because God has spoken. Right from Genesis chapter 1, God has spoken all the way through. We can have confidence that here God has spoken and wants us to understand things for our own lives. So this inspiration then, Peter says, for no prophecy has ever yet originated with man's will. It didn't come from man thinking up for himself. Freud talks in terms of religion being Freud talks in terms of religion being man deluding himself, making a god in his own image. And yet the God is revealed in the Bible is the opposite of that. Because in Freud's idea, if man wants to do something a bit like the old idol concept in Isaiah, where you chop a piece of wood in two, and one piece you warm yourself in the fire, the other one you stick up in a niche somewhere and you bow down and worship it, and then one day you say to the idol, I want to go out and rape somebody. And the idol says, well, that's a good idea, why don't you? And off you trot and you do what you want, basically, because the idol, a piece of wood, is not going to tell you, don't do that, because the idol's only going to reflect what you want to do. And therefore, but when you listen to the prophets, God time after time after time says, hey, don't do that, you're doing the wrong thing, you need to be doing this. And he challenges us to do not what we want to do, but something different, what God wants us to do. And that's the real difference. So Freud got it totally wrong when he said that man was creating God in his own image. Because no prophecy ever came by man's own will, but that which originated from God. God instigated what he wants man to understand. And provided we hang around with that, provided we understand that and apply it in the right way, then we can have confidence in what God has said, what God has revealed in his word for each one of us to live our lives. So, the Living Bible says in 2 Timothy 3, verse 16, the whole Bible was given to us, in Timothy's case, basically the Old Testament, because New Testament hadn't been written then, but all inspiration, all scripture was given to us by inspiration from God and is useful to teach us what is true, to make us realize what is wrong in our lives, and to straighten us out and help us to do what is right. To make the other authorized version is better in the sense of it, to be complete. God wants us to be complete people, fulfilled people, people that are broadened out in every aspect of our lives to be the kind of people God wants us to be, to reach our full potential, if you will. And that's what the Bible's there for. Quite often people look at the Bible and say, the Bible's holding me back. It's a book of don't do this and don't do that. Whereas the opposite is true often, that we are challenged to do stuff, to be right. And the things that are wrong in our lives, if we're focused on doing the right, the wrong will drop off. We'll do less and less the wrong because our focus and our mind will be doing on that which is right with God. And how do we know what is right? By understanding, by studying the Word of God. He'll help us to know the right thing and the wrong thing. Again, the Apostle Paul in Romans makes it very clear. If we understand the Word of God, if we study the Word of God, then we can be able to use a funny kind of word. Use the word discern. It means the word, the idea, we will be able to tell the difference between the things that are right and the things that are wrong, and the attitudes that are right and the attitudes that are wrong. And because we grow more and more like Christ, and we understand more of what Christ wants for our lives, then we learn how to do the right thing. And it also highlights the fact that when we make a mess of things, we know what we've done wrong, because we'll understand that better as well. And it's all part of that process. So, Judas was one of the original apostles, and that's a tremendous privilege. How many people can say that he walked and talked with Christ for 3 years, almost 3 years of his life? But Luke tells us a number of things about Judas, just a couple of them we're going to hear. He says he purchased a field with the wages of sin, which Frank referred to earlier. He purchased a field with the wages of sin.
That can be a little bit misleading because he didn't do that for buying.
No, we're going to come back to that.
It's simple. Oh, you're going to mention that?
Hopefully, yes.
Oh,
yes.
Don't come to that. Oh, sorry.
Hopefully, that's okay. No off. Problem. I think in my notes, I can take time to explain a little bit better. I mean, I think on one of these slides we're going to come to it. If we don't, we'll come back to it anyway and talk about it. So Judas died a horrible death, and the field became known as the Field of Blood. Okay, Luke says the name was given because of the horrible way that Jesus died. Matthew says that it was given because it was purchased with the blood money. Okay, now that's a lot of people who are critics of the Bible, the critics of Christians, say there you are, it's a contradiction. You know, Luke says the name was because of the horrible way he died. Matthew says it was purchased with blood, because it was purchased with blood. So there must be a problem there. That's contradiction of scripture. Okay? So some people say that Matthew and Luke contradict each other. Here's another instance where Matthew says Judas hanged himself, and Luke says he fell and his bowels burst out. You know, well, obviously, here's two totally different stories, isn't it? But it's when they put the two
not
together.
Well, not necessarily.
Of course. For a lot of people. That's what they say. Matthew says he hanged himself, and Luke says his bowels fell out. So how did he die? Did he die by hanging, or did he die because his bowels fell out? But actually, it's not a contradiction, but it's complementary. There you are. See? Okay. All things come to he who waits. All right. Not a contradiction, but complementary. He gives us additional information. Judas was hanged. And then, because of the heat and everything else, outside there in the sun, whatever happened, either the rope gave way or his neck gave way, one of the two. And as he fell, his innards came out. Okay, and so both were right when you understand the thing. And you get that a lot in scripture. You get and especially the gospels. A lot of people say, look at all these contradictions all the way through the gospels. but it's not as additional information, it's not contradictions. These two here, Matthew 16, verse 51, when you get one story, you're told that the one who drew the sword was Peter. But you've got to read the other story to find out that the one who got his, the servant who got his ear cut off was called Malchus. If you only had the one, you don't have half the story. But when you put the two together, you get the full story. And that happens all the time in the Gospels. And so they're not contradictory information. It's actually additional information. And it's when you put everything together, and that's why it's important to read the context and to understand the context and understand the wider context of all the different books and how they all fit together. And that's why Peter later on does that. He says, we need to learn to rightly divide the Word of God, rightly understand where everything fits together. And a lot of the supposed, as the atheists or agnostic or people who are against Christianity say, a lot of the contradictions that they put forward just disappear. Just disappear. Because we see the bigger picture. They're not interested in the bigger picture. Okay? So, the psalm talks in terms of judgment against Christ's betrayer. We need to compare some other stuff as well. That's another psalm deal with. One of them deal with the fact that the things that Jesus knew about Judas, that he was going to betray him. He was his best friend, well, he's a good friend, and that friend was going to betray him in that way. And also that these other psalms have got something else to do with that. I'm not going to look at those. Judas lost his position as apostle, and another would take his place. Okay? So here was this man who walked and talked with Jesus for 3 years. But why, when Judas died, didn't they just leave it like that? Why didn't the 11 go off and do all the things they were going to do? Why was it important, you think, for another to take the place of the 12, to make up the 12? Lots of speculation. Some people say, well, the reason why Jesus chose 12, because there were 12 tribes, and 12 is almost a recurring number in some aspects of Scripture, so it's an important thing. The other thing is that obviously there was a purpose for that 12, and the key purpose was they were going to be witnesses. And that's the reason given for Matthias being chosen ultimately to replace Judas. He was to become one with the others, to be witnesses of this special situation. So we look at the why did they just say, okay, you'll do, and bring somebody else to be one of the 12? Why have to be qualifications? But it's an interesting thing in all the way through Scriptures. When God designates a job description, if you will, for example, and later on in the New Testament, we talk about elders. Now, in its generic and its wider sense of being used, Frank is an elder because he's an older person. And I'm getting there. In a few more years, I may be called an elder by some of you younger whippersnappers. But the reality is, I'm getting older. And so it's a general term in which I could be described as an elder. But then when you look in the biblical qualifications for an elder in the church, there's three different words for the term elder. Elder being the older person, the elder, the pastor, and the...
Oh, you mean us, the shepherd?
Yeah, the shepherd.
Yeah, the bishop, and the bishop.
And the bishop. So you get the same person described in three different terms. So one of the qualifications that he's laid down, he's been an older person. But another qualification, he needs to be able to shepherd the flock. And so on and so forth. So the Bible gives you a term, and then it defines that term, gives you qualifications for that term. So here we have the 12 apostles, the 11 apostles, Judas dies, and then they say another to be the 12th. And they don't just pick anybody at random, they actually choose somebody who has certain qualifications. And the qualifications are clearly laid out. And that happens a lot in Scripture, where if the Bible lays down qualifications for an individual, or gives you a title for an individual, usually find somewhere a bunch of qualifications that show if you wear that title, this is the kind of person you ought to be, or this is the kind of things you ought to have in order to make sure of that. So, and here we have the requirements of an apostle. One of the requirements for an apostle, we've known in Corby here, up in Kingswood, Apostle John. We had a few run-ins with the Apostle John over a period of time. One of our elderly ladies lived quite close to him, and she was ill, quite ill one time. And the Apostle Paul John says, Apostle John said that, you come along and we'll heal you. And she went along to the little apartment where they had a little prayer meeting and a healing meeting, and he broke her arm. Very nice. I think one of the local policemen had a quiet word with the gentleman. He said, "You ever go near her again, we'll not stop you." And her doctor wasn't exactly happy with the situation. Anyway, here we have a proper qualification for the Apostle John. If that guy up in Kingswood was a genuine apostle, using these qualifications, then he was quite an old gentleman, because he hadn't been around for 2,000 years. So, from the baptism of John until the ascension of Christ. So we saw John the Baptizer in the life of Jesus, and then we saw Jesus himself come on the scene, and then he lived his life as an example to all, and then ultimately he was crucified, and then he ascended to heaven. And so one of the major qualifications for somebody to replace Judas was that he must have been with the apostles from the very beginning, from the work of John the Baptizer, right up until the ascension, and been a witness of all these things. John 15 says he must be with him from the beginning. Then we had the reason for this was to be he had to be a witness of the resurrection of Christ. And the resurrection of Christ is crucial. If this man who was to replace Judas hadn't seen the risen Christ, hadn't been there at the resurrection of Christ, he wouldn't have been able to witness one of the core testimonies of the reality of our salvation. If Christ isn't risen, and the person who's saying, "Look, Christ was risen, but he wasn't there to see it," he couldn't really be a witness to that or testify to that in the first century. So he must have personally seen and be willing to be able to tell others about this amazing situation took place where Christ was raised from the dead. He had to prove that the Christ Jesus was truly the long-awaited Messiah. He had to be able to understand much of the intricacies of the Old Testament and the claims of Jesus in his life, have heard them, listened to the arguments of Jesus, and be able to be involved in all that. The fact that because that's another key cornerstone, that Jesus was the Messiah. He was the one that Jewish people had been waiting for. And perhaps it's interesting when we come to chapter 2, that the first people who become Christians are Jews. They also are convinced by the message of these people that Christ truly was who claimed to be. Luke 24 says, all these things must be fulfilled. Talking about that in the Psalms and the prophets and all the Old Testament, Jesus said, must be fulfilled in the one who was to claim to be the Messiah. And in talking on the road to Emmaus, which is background to this, he actually says that. You know, it's been fulfilled in me. I am the one who you've been waiting for. And so, why is it important? They had to prove that the Christ suffered and rose. Romans 1 verse 4, the very beginning of Paul's book in Romans, he says, one of the most important basic issues that proved that Christ was who he claimed to be was the reality of his resurrection. Jesus in his lifetime said, "I'm going to die, but in 3 days I'm going to be raised again." So he said that time after time after time. If he hadn't been raised again, Jesus himself would be seen as a false prophet. Because what a prophet, if a person claims to be a prophet, whatever he talks about must come true. So Jesus told them time after time that he was going to be raised from the dead. And Romans chapter 1 verse 4, he says, he was declared to be the Son of God with power through the resurrection. It was the final stamp of divine approval on everything that Jesus had done in his life. And they were to be eyewitnesses of that final stamp. So that only the apostles served as these eyewitnesses. And that's just it. Okay? Anyway, and it's interesting. All these passages are interesting when you put them all together. Chapter 2, verse 32, 3, verse 15, 5, verse 29, 10, verse 39. We've got a lack of time. We won't go through all these. Oh, we might. No, we won't. We might actually stop with this one. I will go through them a little more slowly. Okay. I'll read them to you. I haven't put my other one up in the thing. In chapter 2, verse 23, part of Paul's, verse 32, part of Paul's Peter's sermon, he says, verse 22. This Jesus God raised up, and we are all witnesses. Okay? 3 verse 15, he says, verse 13, 14, 15. And he killed, well, start with verse 14, but you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a martyr to be granted to you and killed the author of life whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. I'll go down to 4 verse 33, just because it's easier to go that way than come back all the way. 4 verse 33 says, and with great power the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. The word in their testimony is their witnesses to that fact there. 5 verse 29, we'll start there. Verse 27 says, and they brought them, they set them before the council and the high priest, questioned them, saying, we strictly charge you not to teach in this name. You have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us. But Peter turned and the apostles answered, we must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by the hanging on a tree. God exalted him at the right hand as leader and saviour, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. We are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God had given to those who obey him. And then in chapter 10, way further along here, I think you're getting the point. Okay, it's interesting how all this, you know, you don't sometimes notice this when you just read individual passages. When you put them all together, you've got a strong testimony all the way through. 10 verse 39, you have, and we are witnesses to all that he did, both in the country of the Jews in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and made him manifest, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And here's Peter saying here, you know, you can believe, you can trust what we have to say, because we were there. We were God witnesses to the fact that Jesus died in this way, that he walked this way, that he died in this way, that he was raised from the dead in this way. And therefore our testimony is true. And the final one there in chapter 13, verse 31, it says, when they had fulfilled all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead, and for many days he appeared to those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to the people. We bring you the good news that what God promised the fathers, he has fulfilled to us, his children. Okay? And there's other stuff in there as well. We'll hold it at that. I think we'll hold it at that because there's no point going any further. I'll just give you a glance at the next screen so you're keen for next week, okay? But the force of the testimony. We're 12 in number, not just one or two. They were united in the testimony of what they'd seen and what they'd heard, and they were fearless in the testimony. These men who were running away in a campfire in Jerusalem there, these are the same men who you saw scattering into nowhere when Jesus was about to be crucified, are now standing up boldly before people and proclaiming. What a difference in them. What made a difference? Because they knew the resurrected Christ. Now, hopefully, when we ask some questions and we maybe want to scatter away and hide on a table somewhere because people are asking awkward questions. Perhaps if we really come to understand everything that Christ has done for us, maybe we will gain the confidence to be under courage to stand up and tell people, we believe in the risen Christ. You may ridicule him, you may laugh at him, you may laugh at Christians in general, but we believe, and that belief makes such a difference in our lives. So we're willing to testify, we're willing to challenge you for the message of God, because based upon eyewitness accounts, these men of long ago were the witnesses of everything that Jesus did. And we'll hold it there. Keep going more. Even the point of death. Okay.